In 1966, the separatist RAN party fields a slate under Pierre Bourgault. Unexpectedly, the conservative vote puts an end to La Révolution Tranquille by re-electing Duplessis' old party, the Union Nationale, now led by Daniel Johnson. The separatists get 10% of the vote. The following year, Quebec is the star of Canada's centennial, but some of the guests prove difficult. Charles de Gaulle, unlike the Queen, is enthusiastically welcomed by the Québécois. But he antagonizes Canada by confusing his trip through Quebec with the liberation of France. He shortens his visit by encouraging separatism from the balcony of the Montreal City Hall.
Et je puis vous dire qu'elle en vaudra mieux. Vive Montréal! Vive le Québec!
The general may have his own opinions on the Canadian Confederation, but the problem of the Constitution and of Canada will be resolved here in Canada.
But in Canada, separatism is quickly becoming a respectable political movement. It spreads to the Quebec House of Commons, where a key member of the Provincial Liberal Party, René Lévesque, publishes a manifesto demanding special rights for Quebec. This causes consternation amongst his fellow Liberals, such as Eric Kearns. Although hopes that the breach between the Liberals and Lévesque can be mended are expressed by Robert Bourassa.
I was a bit encouraged this afternoon. I think the atmosphere was much better this afternoon.
Dans le Québec, notre position à nous!
Lévesque is dropped by the Liberals, and he forms his own independentist movement. But the next election is a federal election. Trudeau takes over as Prime Minister. Trudeau's platform is national unity, an end to separatism.
Some people, I think, are afraid of the word confrontation. They think you can get more by giving in to extremists. I don't believe that.
On the eve of the 68 election, Trudeau goes to participate in Quebec's Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day celebrations. Pierre Bourgault and many of the other separatists there felt that Trudeau was a traitor to Quebec. Soon, bottles aimed at Trudeau begin to fly, hitting spectators in the crowd. The protesters' aim improves, and the police charge blindly into the crowd. Watched on television by millions of voters, Trudeau angrily refuses to be chased away by the separatists. The police and the protesters battle below him, while the parade goes on, oblivious. Canadians from coast to coast are saddened by the spectacle of Québécois fighting Québécois. And the next day, supported by both French and English, Trudeau will win the election easily on a wave of Trudeau mania. British Canada makes it clear that they expect Trudeau to snuff out the separatists. But Lévesque and Bourgault join forces, and the turbulent RAN disappears forever into the newer, bigger, more moderate separatist party, the Parti Québécois. As a Liberal minister, Lévesque had shown that he could run Quebec. Now a separatist and a socialist, he is elected leader of the new party, and for the first time, the separatists become a credible alternative to the traditional parties. And things are moving on the Union front, where more and more, Separatism and union strife are becoming interrelated. Montreal taxi drivers go out on strike, protesting against poor pay, insecurity, and the Anglophone Murray Hill monopoly over the lucrative hotel and airport taxi trade. Some of the drivers blockade the streets, and they are arrested. But soon the police themselves are on strike. During the day, the abandoned streets of Montreal are peaceful, while the police meet at the Paul Sauvé Arena. Like many other Quebec workers, the policeman's goal is income parity with English-speaking Ontario, and Mayor Drapeau and his administrator, Lucien Saunier, are cast as the villains. That evening, the unprotected city erupts into violence and looting. Old wounds are avenged, and Mayor Drapeau's expensive restaurant, Le Vaisseau d'Or, is sacked. While a nervous Montreal stays behind closed doors, the workers and the capitalists clash head-on. Striking taxi drivers and some extremist sympathizers attack the Murray Hill garages. The property is defended by armed guards. Several people are injured, and a plainclothes policeman is killed, mysteriously shot in the back. Two members of the FLQ, Marc Carbonneau and Jacques Lanctot, are wounded in the attack. It will not be the last time these two have something to do with the Canadian Army being called in to protect Montreal. Next, it is the postal workers protesting the federal government's treatment of the LAPAM drivers. The LAPAM drivers themselves stay on and on in Ottawa, a constant reminder to the House of Commons that all is not well with the workers of Quebec. And then there is the other great question, the survival of the French language and culture in Quebec. This issue draws support from many people who are not separatists. There are the huge Saint-Léonard and Bill 63 demonstrations. The French Canadians insist that if immigrants are allowed to speak English, the French language and culture will vanish into the ocean of English-speaking North America. The immigrants insist on having the right to choose their own language. In this crowd is another member of the FLQ, Paul Rose. And then Robert Shaw, a McGill University administrator, finds himself facing the McGill Francais movement, which includes a number of Anglophones.
Four or five of those.
But many who are not revolutionaries sympathize because the rights of the English minority in Quebec have always been far better protected than those of the French elsewhere in Canada. And justice for the French majority has not always been sure, as Valier and Gagnon know only too well when they are finally let out on bail. Gagnon states through his interpreter, lawyer Robert Lemieux, that he will continue to work for
the realization of the independence of the people of Quebec,
as are many of the artists and performers of Quebec. In 1970, a crucial provincial election. Cardinal divides the incumbent right-wing Union Nationale, now under the shaky Bertrand. For the first time, the separatists have a chance to take power, so the federal liberals nervously throw their weight behind their provincial counterparts.
Pour reprendre dans la province de Québec, mesdames et messieurs,